The number of feral hogs we have is so excessive in many places that simple control by hunting or trapping is not enough. With over 2 million hogs in Texas, we're not going to barbecue our way out of this problem.
Very simply, a wild pig is nothing more than a wild living individual belonging to the species Sus scrofa. This species is not native to the Western Hemisphere. These animals were introduced here by man from the Old World. It goes back as far as to Columbus's second voyage in 1493, where he brought 8 domestic pigs from the Canary Islands and introduced those into the Caribbean. Those animals were then brought to the mainland and have now been dispersed throughout a good bit of North America. In the late 1800s, wealthy sportsmen decided to bring pure Eurasian wild boar over here, and in places where these two forms of wild pigs coexisted, hybridization occurred. So currently in the United States, we've got 3 types of wild pigs. We've got feral pigs, wild pigs that are solely of domestic ancestry. We've got a few small pockets of pure Eurasian wild boar, but most of these populations are hybridized animals from both of these two parental stocks.
As a result of their diverse ancestry and to some extent their environment, wild pigs come in a variety of colors and sizes. The most common color phase tends to be black or dark brown, but individuals may be nearly any color or combination of colors. Weights and sizes of wild pigs are often exaggerated. As a general rule, males are larger than females. The average weight of an adult male is around 220 pounds. And adult females average around 155 pounds. However, as a result of their diverse ancestry and resource availability, size differences exist at both the individual and population level.
Wild pigs have a very high reproductive potential. They mature at a very young age. They have litter sizes that average 5 to 6. I've heard, though, the average litter size is 6. Typically out of which about 8 survive. Physiologically, one sow can produce 3 litters in a 14-month period of time. We've got one sow now that was 14 years old when she was collected, known age, and that animal was pregnant. So these animals have an incredible potential to crank out new pigs every year. When you've got a very small population in an area, if you don't get in there very quickly and eradicate it, before you know it, you turn around and you had 100 pigs there, now you've got 1,000. They are the ultimate generalist as far as being a survivor. They can live in just about any habitat, anywhere from the Canadian prairie provinces down to the deserts in Mexico and all parts in between. As long as they're given access to water, escape cover, and food, and shade, pigs can live pretty much anywhere.
The Southeastern Cooperative Wildlife Disease Study has been mapping the distribution of feral swine in the United States since 1982. We have a website, National Feral Swine Mapping System. Anyone, the general public to agencies, can go on the home page and look at the current up-to-date data on the distribution of feral swine. What we're seeing in the expansion is basically evidence of 2 different processes. In the Southeast, we've seen a natural expansion of the feral swine populations from those initial distributions. And this is through natural reproduction and dispersal of these animals. We've also, however, seen a process where we have distant populations beginning in new states. And this isn't a natural expansion of feral swine. This is through humans moving these animals from the Southeast or other areas into these new states.
Very simply, what happened was between the end of the 1980s and the present, wild pigs had become the second most popular big game animal in North America, second only to white-tailed deer in numbers harvested every year. And those hunters, especially in the northern tier of states that wanted to hunt these animals but they didn't want to drive south, they very quickly figured out this is something they could fix. All you had to do was get a trailer load of pigs, you could trap them, buy them, whatever, take them to wherever you wanted them, and turn them loose, and pigs did the rest.
Feral swine are very hardy animals. They have a high reproductive potential. They're omnivores, they're strong, enduring animals, and they're able to, in a lot of these areas, if enough animals are brought into the area, establish a population and then start spreading again.
In addition, because these are such a popular big game animal, there's a lot of commercial fenced shooting operations in this country that offer wild boar hunts. Pigs don't fence very well.
In Texas, we say that any fence that will hold water will hold hogs. Fences may be hog resistant, but they're not hog proof, and eventually hogs will be able to breach any fence.
Between those clandestine illegal releases and those escapees from these fenced enclosures, this is where this expansion has come from.
Wild pigs often leave distinctive field signs that make it easy to tell whether or not pigs have moved into an area. Rooting is probably the most common and recognizable field sign created by wild pigs. Rooting damage is the result of pigs turning over soil or ground cover in search of invertebrates, roots, and tubers. Another telltale sign of wild pigs is the wallows they create to cool their body temperature and rid themselves of external parasites. Wild pigs construct nests or beds to protect their young from weather and predation and to serve as resting or loafing spots. Mud rubs on trees, fence posts, and utility poles are often visible within the immediate vicinity of wild pig wallows. Wild pigs frequently rub against these and other upright, sturdy objects to remove excess mud and external parasites from their coats after wallowing. Rubs are not always associated with wallows. Isolated rubs on creosoted poles and posts are common. Oftentimes, people mistake wild pig tracks for deer tracks and vice versa. Pig tracks are more rounded at the tips of the hooves and have more widely spread dew claws. Ha ha ha!